Master. Very nice place.
Oh,
right, Master. I'm in Scotland still,
yes.
And the distinguished brethren and ladies, it's a very great honor for me to be here. Before I start on the business of the day, the paper which I'm going to present to you, it would be remiss of me if I did not publicly thank the Grand Lodge of Missouri, or Missouri, as I was told. I have to be careful about this, for the very generous hospitality and the courteous welcome throughout my very short stay here in Columbia. I have been looking forward to making this trip for some considerable time, and normally when I come to the States on lecture tours, it's to the eastern seaboard, but I'm gradually working my way west, and hopefully I may get to California. Well, I take the risk of going to California, maybe, I don't know, sometime in the future. But I am delighted and honored and privileged to be here amongst you. And I'd like to think that I have begun to make some close friends. I have no gifts to give, but I only have a warm heart and a strong hand of friendship, and I hope that that will suffice. If I did, it would be remiss of me, of course, not to thank a few individuals, the Grand Secretary and the office staff there, have been most courteous and very diligent in making all kinds of arrangements for me. And in particular, I want to thank publicly a friend and a brother, Aaron Shoemaker, for all that he has done to make this possible right from the start. And I know that you brethren here and ladies will know, most of you will know, that he is a very diligent, careful, caring, sincere Christian gentleman, and I hold him in high estimation, and I know that he's a young man with many talents and skills, and I certainly look forward, as past master of quite a Coronati Lodge in London, the premier lodge of research in the world, and with some connections with the United Grand Lodge of England, which I do have, it would be possible, perhaps, in the future, with young guys like this gentleman, and, of course, the office bearers in the lodge as well, to prosper the Missouri Lodge of Research in connection with the Quattro Coronati Lodge, and even my own lodge in Scotland, Lodge Sir Robert Murray. If I get an opportunity, I'll tell you a little bit about that. I'm going to be moving around, as is my wont, and I'm going to be speaking from there. And I've got, you see, I'm high-tech. I've got this high-tech flip chart here, and I'll be drawing things on that, not many, too many things. So I hope that you'll be able to hear me, and you'll be able to pick up at least something. And your indulgence in my accent, of course, will be paramount. And I hope you will you'll be able to understand what I am saying to you. I know that you will do that in your usual Missouri courtesy. And now to the business.
I'm doing it now. Okay, right, fine, thank you. I'm going to move there, and if you can't hear me at the back, you just sort of wave a hand and I'll start shouting. Nobody goes to sleep where I am.
I'm holding that. That's good. Okay. Oh my goodness.
I brought the music with me as well.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. By way of explanation for this, I was hooked up to one of these things when I was giving a lecture as prestigious as this in England one time, and I have forgotten that I had it switched on. And so I was going around talking to district grand masters and some other important gentlemen, and we were having a very delicate kind of conversation about things. And the little guy came running up to me and he said, Trevor,
You're still hooked up. The conversation's going all over the building.
I hope that doesn't happen this morning. I think I've learned my lesson from that.
Okay.
Because you're all interested in doing Masonic research and are interested in Masonic history in some way, I thought that I would offer you a model for doing Masonic research. This is something that I have been working on for some time, and although it may seem theoretical to begin with, it does get more concrete when I actually I use an English example of something rather terrible that happened to a brother in England during the Great War, the First World War. And I'm using that to illustrate the general points that I'm going to be making. When we are trying to do Masonic research, one of the things that we would try to do to begin with is to tell a story in that sense. We can, in fact, construct a story about lodges, particular persons, particular people, particular events, particular objects, it may well be. And we could begin to describe these, to tell the story from A to B, to C to D, and so on. And I call that, if I may, the kind of narrative level. I don't think where you'll be able to, maybe you'll not be able to see that, but at the basic level of questioning, the basic kind of storytelling. When you go to, say, the Masonic Library, and you're going to try and do some Masonic research, or you're just browsing through, or you may well be just interested in the history of your old lodge, or lodges, or units, Masonic units, you will usually find that they deal with it in a chronological narrative way, and there's nothing wrong with that. It's an interesting kind of thing to do, and it produces all kinds of interesting details. I won't go into them now, and those of you who are interested, you will get the details from the printed paper there. But in a way, it is rather limited in the kind of story that you're telling. It's almost that the history was written as though everything else outside had never really happened. I mentioned the First World War, and I'll illustrate the kind of point I mean. We came across lodge records, the minute books, for instance, of lodges, or the histories that they had written based on those minute books, and it's almost as though the Great War, we call it the Great War in Europe, the Great War had almost has never happened. It kind of passes them by. When you think of the slaughter on the battlefields in France and Belgium and so on, but it never happened. There's no real mention of it. Actually, there is, because sometimes you come across the kind of reference in the minute books of the lodges will say, and we couldn't have our usual meal because the food was rationed. Huh. Well, that's the kind of impact that they thought the war was having, maybe, on their lodge. Guys would be killed, members would be killed, relatives of members would be killed, but although, apart from a brief reference, the Great War just passed them by. Now, that's what I call a self-referential kind of history. Nothing wrong with it, but really, from a historical point of view, from my point of view as a historian, I would want something rather different. And that is why I have looked at and tried to develop a model of doing Masonic history, which I call ripples in a pool. Let me just give you an image. And we've all done this at some time when we were kids. We stood by a quiet piece of water, a lake or a pool or something like that. We have a stone in our hand, and we throw it into the pool, and there's a splash. And that's not the end of the story, of course, because what happens from there are ever-widening ripples, the concentric rings of rippling across the surface of the pool. That's the image that I would like you to keep in your minds when considering doing Masonic history. The initial impact and then ever-widening pools of ripples across the surface of the pool. Let me explain. Go back to the idea of the narrative way of doing Masonic research from a historical point of view. There's nothing wrong with that, as I said. However, it's not very good history. I'm going to then suggest another ripple around that. And I call that a contextual kind of question. Okay, let's see. Contextual. So that you are attempting, by your questions, to put the narrative into some kind of panoramic context. A 360-degree view of things that were happening elsewhere, at the same time perhaps, or in the same way, in order to put the little event into a wider perspective. And then after that, of course, there is an ever wider view, which will be, I call it, perhaps, the philosophical. I'll get to that, and that's the controversial one, but I'll get to that in a little while. The narrative questions, who, where, when, how, and so on, little questions like that at the narrative level. Contextually, where, what was happening elsewhere? Were there any parallels elsewhere, and so on? What's the wider perspective, perhaps a district level, national level, international level, and then the more philosophical things which are difficult to formulate and more difficult to answer, of course. That's the theoretical model. Now I want to make it more concrete for you and tell you about something that happened in England and about to a particular person. And what I'd like you to try to take away from this is that if you're interested in doing any kind of research, or you're interested in reading about research that others have done, if you keep this model in mind and say, how far does what I'm doing, or how far does what the other guys have written about, measure up with this? Now, it may be that it is defective. In fact, it could well be. It's under development in that way. But at least it's a starting point for looking objectively at Masonic historiography, Masonic history in that way, Masonic history writing in that way. I'm going to put a name up on the board. It's a name which will mean nothing to you, but by the time you finish, and I finish today, I hope you'll take this name away with you, because he's a little guy of no real social importance and no real Masonic importance, except I hope to make him important in Freemasonry just by the way in which I talk about him today. Gustav Petri, a little Austrian guy, a gentleman and a gentleman. Engaging in his dispositions. He was born in 1866. He was employed in Austria as a mining, something to do with the mines, the coal mines. In a managerial capacity, he wasn't an actual coal miner, but he was a kind of administrator, a clerk in that way. And he came to the north of England to a seaport. The name is irrelevant in a way, but this was a very busy place in the 19th century for the export of coal. And a lot of the trade and the wealth of that particular port was based on the coal trade. And he found employment with some of the local mine owners, and he was employed to organize the export of the coal through the on ships going north-south from the port. Of course, that placed him in a prominent position socially, in a way, because he quickly, inevitably, became the attention of other guys who were employed in the same kind of trade, and of course, some of them were Masons. They invited him to join quite an old lodge. It's a lodge that was dating back at least to 1755, and it was based just near the wharfs, the docks in the port. He joined it, and he became very quickly a steward, which is a guy who works just helping his brethren when they're having the meals, serving at the table. A full member of the lodge, and a quiet gentleman who was greatly liked. He had no Masonic ambitions whatsoever. He just simply wanted to be a member of the lodge and enjoy going to the meetings. This lodge was quite an old lodge as far as England is concerned, although in Scotland we have lodges which are much older. But I can't resist getting that one in. We have lodges that actually were described in Scotland as ancient, even in 1599. So anyway, this lodge in this particular town, dating from about 1755, and it was a popular lodge. Being a seaport, of course, a lot of people joined it, and it was difficult to get to the chair. They had, in those days, about 200 members, which is a big lodge for England. And so, they decided, some of the older, wiser guys decided they were going to set up a daughter lodge. And this was going to meet in the same building, and they needed some founders, guys who would be charter members, and they invited Gustav Petri to be one of them. And he accepted, he resigned, he demitted from his Mother Lodge, once the new lodge had been consecrated and set up, and he had the pride of being able to be a steward again. And that's all he did. He gradually worked his way up the line to becoming a senior warden. And everything was going fine. Like all new lodges, you guess you know that it goes off, they get a lot of initiates, guys who wanted to join, and so on. Everything was fine. Until the outbreak of the First World War. And then something dramatic happened, which I have called Masonically dreadful. The local provincial Grand Master, or you call this district deputy or something like that, was a gentleman called Lord Barnard. He was an aristocrat, local aristocrat, big landowner. His family goes way back in history, and he was the provincial grandmaster, and he'd been the provincial grandmaster for some time. Not like you have in the States. Once they're appointed, and if they keep their nose right and clean, we have the expression, they're okay. As long as they're okay, they're not replaced. So Barnard lived in a castle, and he had all the kind of attitudes of that class of people in those days. We're talking 1914 here, 1914. And he, without taking advice from his deputy or anyone else, he issued a letter to all the 60 lodges in his area, saying that with the outbreak of the war, it would be better, indeed it was his wish, that the brethren who were of German, or Austrian, or Hungarian, or Turkish nationality, who were deemed to be, at that time, members of an enemy race, but members of the lodges, it would be better that they would return to their native countries. In obedience to the kind of sentiments and ideas that were expressed in the first degree charge that the brethren are supposed to pay due obedience to the sovereign of their native land from which they derive their birth and infant nurture. That's a phrase that's from an English ritual. And this letter went out to all the lodges. I have seen the copy. They were read out, and it was read out in Gustav Petri's lodge, and being the obedient, humble mason that he was, he decided that he would have to resign from the lodge that he'd helped to found, and he would have to leave England and go out. And so he did. And the lodge received his resignation with great sadness. We've got the letters there, the minutes were all noted down by the secretary of the lodge that this was a disappointing thing to have happened to them. Well, if I wanted to tell a story, and that's not the end of the story, I'll come back to it a little later, but if you wanted to write that story and tell it, I've just given you a few details. Then you could, of course, work at the narrative level. Perfectly respectable thing to do. You could find out all about Gustav Petri. You could go, perhaps, you could go to Austria, or you could travel a bit. You could find out where he came from, how old he was when he came over to the UK, and so on. You could go into a lot of detail, chronologically building up the story. Nothing wrong with it, but it's not very good history in that way. However, if you wanted to contextualize it, in other words, you wanted to widen the ripples, and you wanted to put it into something like a 360-degree reference, a view of it, then you would have to go further. You would probably have to travel a good deal further. You may well be engaged in translating from other languages and so on. So that maybe, I'll give you some examples. What was happening in, say, the German lodges who had British brethren who were residents? Did they treat their British guys in the same way? To use another example, and I don't know the answer to this, and some of you may be able to help me in this. During the Second World War, you had Japanese brethren lodges. What happened to them? Were they told to go? Or were they interned? I don't know. I'm an ignorant Scot, but that's the kind of context there that I'm interested in. There was a fair degree of controversy. And part of the contextualization of this incident, this little Gustav Petri incident, would be to find out what happened in England in other districts, in other provinces. Were there other provincial grand masters like Lord Byron? What did they do? What did the brethren think about it at that time? We know what this particular lodge brethren thought. They were astonished and they were shocked. But he was the provincial grand master. Well, he's the boss, so, well, you do what he tells you. I'm interested also in this whole notion of xenophobia, the fear of the stranger, particularly in time of war. And that xenophobic kind of question would come into the contextualization there. In the UK, there was a fair bit of xenophobia stirred up in movies, in books, novels, in the newspapers, in the cartoons, in the brochures, in the pamphlets, in the posters that were pasted up and down, and so on. German spies and Austrian spies were found on every bed, so they thought. And it was, of course, encouraged by the government at that time. The propaganda is a very useful tool in time of war. I don't need to tell you and remind you, brother and folks, of that. So you could contextualize this little Austrian guy, put a wider framework. Part of that would be to find out what the Grand Lodge in London thought. And we have the minutes. I'll tell you what happened in June 1915. It was a, what they call a quarterly communication, a great assembly of the of Grand Lodge. Interestingly enough, the gentlemen, the brethren who assembled there, were a cross-section of the establishment. Bishops, great lawyers, military guys, generals, major generals, all that sort of thing, and of course the usual MPs, members of parliament, that kind of person. The real elite of the day, in that sense, they're the sort of Grand Lodge office bearers there. And the meeting started at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and it went on until 10 o'clock at night. And I can tell you, there was a fair bit of Masonic blood being spilled that day. The Grand Master was out of the country at that time, but he had his deputy there, and you see what deputies can get up to or have to do it on occasions, right, Virtual Sir? He had to carry the can, as we say. He was in charge, he had the gavel, and he had to gavel 5 times for silence, to respect the chair, during the course of this quarterly communication. So high were the temperature in the room, the tempers were really raised. They were raising and discussing, what are they going to do with the foreign brethren? Brethren from Germany, Austria, Hungary, Turkey, and so on, who were members of foreign enemy races, but members of the Lodge. The Grand Secretary had been receiving all kinds of questions from all kinds of lodges, and he could answer the questions on a bit-by-bit basis, but he wanted a debate because he wanted a general policy laid down. And that's the way Grand Secretaries think. It was too much to kind of make it up as you go along. He wanted a general policy, and he brought it to the Lodge. I'll give you some of the questions that he was asked. Suppose a guy who was, let's say, an Austrian or a German, member of the Lodge, and he continued to pay his subscriptions, his dues to the Lodge, in some way. He may well have relatives living in the country, and they pay him his dues on his behalf. He goes off to fight for Germany, or whatever. If he was wounded, and after the war, they assumed that there would be, of course, at the end of the war, after the war he came back, could he claim charity from the Grand Lodge because of his wounds? If he was killed, but he'd married an English lady, or his widow, and he had children, could they claim charity from the Masonic charity because he continued in some way to pay his subscriptions to the Lodge? In fact, could he, if he was continuing to pay somehow his subscriptions to the Lodge, could he actually be considered a member of the Lodge? Could he not be expelled? Because he's an enemy. These kind of questions and all kinds of others were really exercising the minds of secretaries of the Lodge. They wanted guidance about this, and the Grand Secretary, I think, wisely brought it all out into the open. As I say, there was a fair bit of Masonic blood being spilled that day. Tempers were raised. I mean, for example, the Grand Lodge minutes show us that on one occasion someone yelled, you don't normally yell in Grand Lodge, I can tell you, but someone yelled from one side of the room that are we not all Englishmen meeting here? And someone from the other side of the room said, no, we meet first here as Masons. Now that's an interesting idea, isn't it, when you think about it? It reveals the polarity and the attitudes that were going on there at that time. Not patriots, but Masons. I'll return to that theme a little later, if I may. So the contextual operation here would be to put this little Gustav Petri into that kind of context. Actually, the Grand Lodge came up with a brilliant, I thought it was a brilliant idea. He could not, the brethren like this, in this way, and there were many, many, they could not be expelled from their lodges. If they continued to pay their dues, or in some way other people paid dues on their behalf, they were still members of the lodge, or the lodges. The lodge had to continue to receive the dues, and by doing so, they remained members of the lodge, whatever the lodge was. Unless there was another way of getting at the solving the problem. I mean, give you for example, Benedict Arnold, a name that you will know. Now, he was a Mason. He was not expelled from his lodge. He was not guilty of crime in Masonry. Whatever other crimes he may be guilty of, he was not guilty of a crime in Masonry. And he remained a Mason. Much to the chagrin of the Patriots, of course, in this country. Now that's an example of the kind of tension that builds up in these kind of sort of circumstances, usually in wartime. So these guys, these brethren, could not be expelled from their lodges if they somehow or other continued to pay their subscriptions. And so, in a way, in theory, someone raised this problem, in theory, they could actually continue to attend their lodges. You can imagine the kind of circumstances there would be if they had brethren who were on the British side, as it were, on the Allies' side, and they were attending their lodge, and oftentimes they used to do that and attend in uniform. And an Austrian or a German brother, member of the lodge, came and walked in to the lodge. You can imagine the tension that would be created there. And it was that tension that gave the Grand Secretary and one or two other brethren the key to unlock that. They said, look, okay, they have to remain members of the lodge. There's nothing the lodge can do about it unless they are guilty of a Masonic crime. Now, the Masonic crime would be if they continue to attend the lodge after being advised it might be prudent for them not to attend the lodge. In other words, they were going against perhaps the wishes of the lodge expressed through a polite letter from the master or the secretary of the lodge. They would then be guilty of disturbing the harmony of the lodge. And if they do that, that's a Masonic crime. And then they could be proceeded against in a Masonic way. And up the chain it would go, right, if they appeal and appeal and appeal, it could go to Grand Lodge, and then it would be decided upon finally, from which there is no appeal in that way. And they could be expelled in that, for that reason. Well, that was the solution that they came up with. If any brother decided that he was going to exercise his right, having paid his subscriptions, in spite of the fact that he was a member of a foreign race. I'm sorry to have gone on a long time for this kind of contextual thing, but it raises all kinds of interesting kind of questions. If you were going to do that for whatever subject in Masonic history, it would involve a fair bit of travel, a fair bit of collecting data together. You may well find if you collect so much data, you would have to report it in some kind of statistical way, and that might well involve you in kind of chi-square analysis, all kinds of statistical analysis. And you may well find that the volume of information in order to provide the 360-degree view of the incident is so much that you need a cooperator, you need another co-author, and so on. And that's an interesting development, I would think, and I could commend it to you. I have increasingly noticed that some authors actually don't do the single thing, they do cooperate, and they come out, they share the work amongst them, and so on. Okay, so the ever-winding ripples, we extend them to the philosophical thing. Because these are the questions that really puzzle me, and I don't know the answers, but I've raised them for just to complete, as it were, the model. This whole question of Gustav Petri seems to me to raise some difficult questions, such as territoriality. Is it right that there is only one Masonic authority that speaks for Freemasonry within a geographical area? I'm treading on delicate waters, I know, Grandmaster, but from a historical point of view, that's a legitimate question. Who has the right to say, to decide these kinds of things, and on what basis is that authority established and sustained? The whole question of Masonic responsibility in the modern world. Is there a kind of morality that superimposes above all kinds of obligations that we may feel as loyal citizens? After all, Gustav Petri was loyal, and so on, and he was an obedient guy, but was there in that circumstance, and possibly others that you may think of in your country, here in the States, is there an overarching kind of morality in Freemasonry that kind of subsumes the other kinds of obligations that you have? Now, I am aware of the fact that this is a sensitive situation, because you gentlemen and you brethren all salute the flag and so on, and we do, not exactly the same way, in the UK, we stand up and sing God Save the Queen and all of that, but you see, we are fortunate, you brethren, and we in the UK, and others as well, we are fortunate because we live in a state, under the government, as it were, under the state government, the national government, in that sense, which does not persecute Freemasonry. We're lucky in that sense. But suppose that you lived in a country which persecuted Freemasonry, as for example Nazi Germany or Soviet Russia, and they issue, or even for that matter Saudi Arabia, if they legitimate authority of the state persecutes Freemasonry, or questions it, or has some antipathy towards it, to put it mildly, and legislates against it. In what ways, and to what extent, would Masons be justified in obeying their Masonic obligations and saying, no, we will disobey? For example, I quote the American Civil War. And you gentlemen, you brethren, know a lot more than I do about this. But in times of war, you may well find that the brothers on opposing sides have to make very difficult decisions. And oftentimes in battle, that is difficult to do. You have to decide, or perhaps on the instant. Gifted to the, or loaned actually, to the museum. Holbert was imprisoned in a Confederate prison in Amherstville during the war. And just because he was wearing this ring, the guy who was in charge of the jail recognized it because he was a brother and he was able to facilitate and help. I can't remember whether or not he actually helped Holbert to escape, but at least he treated him. And war times, the history of war times, in a Masonic context, are littered with all those kinds of things, those kind of stories, where Freemasons on opposing sides apparently disobeyed orders, perhaps to kill or whatever, and they treated their brethren amicably, fraternally, and graciously. It's as though they were obeying some kind of overarching morality which subsumed the morality, the expectations, the legitimate expectations of the state at that time. Let me concrete it a little further. Suppose that you are an officer on one side of armies, and you're a Mason, and a dedicated one, but you're fighting, you're on the battlefield. Your superior officer, who is not a Mason, and you know him to be not a Mason, gives a command that you are to go out and capture some of the enemy and interrogate them vigorously in order to, those of you who are veterans will know what I mean by vigorously, to get some information, some invaluable information. And then, of course, you do that, that's a legitimate order, he is the established authority in the chain of command and so on, and you go out and you do the job and you eventually manage to get some poor fellow that you're straggling away and you get him back to the camp and you proceed to interrogate him. And you discover that he is a Mason in that circumstance. He may not be very intelligent, but he's a Mason. He's a guy. He is a brotherhood. What do you do? Do you carry out the legitimate orders of your superior officer? With respect that he may be killed, he may die under your interrogation. In order to achieve these essential pieces of information to further the cause which you support? Or do you somehow or other forget or deny or just let him go or whatever? I'm asking the question because this is the kind of question which Gustav Petri, I think, raises. This whole idea of what is patriotism and how does that fit into this whole thing of Freemasonry? I don't know the answer. But these are the kinds of questions, there are others, that historians of Freemasonry get involved. It's not the end of the story, of course. It's not the end of Gustav Petri's story. In 1920, when the Great War had ended 2 years previously, more or less, and things were trying to get back to some kind of, quote, normality, he entered into the pages of history briefly, yet again. I don't think that we would ever really, in terms of civilization, you folks may, I don't know, but in Europe, I don't think we ever really recovered from the Great War. It affected every village, every town, every city. You see the names on the war memorials. Every family lost someone somewhere. These are painful memories. As time goes on, of course, they're not, but we are reminded with the names inscribed on the stone. If I can use a parallel, and I hope it's not ungracious of me to do this, but it's the kind of hurt that brethren and all kinds of citizens of the States felt on 9/11. It went deep, that. And the shock waves echo on and on and on. So you never really recover from a war. You just hope that you can cope with it. So in 1920, they are getting back to some kind of normality. Gustav Petri comes to visit the lodge that he helped to found. Lodge's meeting. I've seen the records. It's all noted down by the secretary in the minute book. Attending on that occasion, as members of the lodge, were two brethren who had lost sons in the Great War. And they're sitting there. Gustav Petri enters his lodge, but this time as a visitor. He gives greetings from his Johannes lodge, his blue lodge. Oh. So while he's been away, He's joined Freemasonry somewhere else. A lodge with a German title. Oh. And then he gives greetings from his St. Andreas Lodge. Now, the St. Andreas Lodge is what we would call perhaps the Green Lodge, and that works the 4, 5, and 6 degrees of the Swedish Rite. This rite is a rite of, it's a series of 11 degrees. The St. Johannes Lodge works 1, 2, 3. St. Andreas works 4, 5, 6. Again, with the German title. Oh dear. And I'll explain why, oh dear. You see, he had not gone back to his native Austria. Because in Austria, if he was joining Freemasonry, he would not have been able to join the Swedish Rite. The Swedish Rite has never been worked in Catholic Austria at all. It has only ever worked in Scandinavian countries and in the north part of Germany. It is a reasonable assumption, because the names of these lodges were German, that he had joined Freemasonry in Germany during the war. Now imagine the tension in that room. Two guys had lost two sons. And yet, the brethren, and it's all laid down, got out of their seats, and they came round and gripped his hand, arms around his shoulders, and welcomed him as a long-lost brother. Now, I don't know about you folks, but that seems to say a lot more about the goodness in the hearts of just ordinary Masons compared with the great high-ups in London and so on. That somehow or other, they had the good sense and tolerance to feel that there was an overarching kind of morality that subsumes the kind of demands that a state would legitimately place upon the citizens of the country. And that is the thing that really engages me with this little man from Austria. That's the thing, that's the lesson that I take home. And it's one which I commend to your careful attention. As I said at the beginning, he's a man of no real consequence. He's of no social importance whatsoever. And yet the lessons that this little incident from the Great War in England has possibly to teach all of us, wherever we may be, I think they're important. If you apply this to any kind of bit of research that you're wanting to do, that model, I think, works. But you've got to be prepared to take something of a risk. Because these questions, particularly on the philosophical level, are not easy to ask, and they're certainly not easy or comfortable to answer. Master, Grand Master Mason, and brethren, you have indulged me with your usual impeccable courtesy, and I have gone far too long, and I'm keeping you from more important things than doing. But before I close, I want to reassure you that we Scots may have a reputation for being mean, but we're not really. And I have no gifts to give you, but I have two little things that I made. Master, it would give me great pleasure if you would accept this paper from me. It was one that I gave at a conference some time ago. It's very academic, and quite different from this, but it has all the citations and so on. And this used card, it's not used card, this syllabus card from my lodge in Edinburgh, and I'll explain to you a little more later on about that. I have the privilege and delight to be the master. They've known me for 17 years, they took a risk. And they thought, well, we think we know this guy, he can be master this guy. So please accept them with my high compliments.
Not a joke. Thank you.
And observing the usual courtesies to the master first, which is the presiding officer, but to the grand master of this fine state of the third, See, I've got it right. Have I? Yes, okay. Please, sir, will you accept these with my compliments? And it's been a very gracious time for me to be here. I'm delighted and honored to be of some assistance to your Grand Marshal. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Proud of you both. May God bless you all and have a wonderful day.